Well, good afternoon. Thank you for inviting me here today. I'm the smallest person that's been on the stage for having to adjust all the microphones. I need to apologize in advance for my accent. The Scots are the only people in the world who speak only one language, that is English, and we speak it so badly that no one understands what we're saying. So I start with an apology for that. Scotland is a bit of a backwater. Our population, the government canvassed the lifestyle of our residents in Scotland, and they asked them lots of questions about their lifestyle. And one of the questions they asked people was, what do you use for protective sex? To which 85% of the Scots responded by saying, the bus shelters. It's a great privilege to be here, and this looks an amazing show, and I'm very excited about everything I've seen so far. Just by way of background, my father was a bus driver, and I did an accountancy training, which I don't always confess to. I usually put myself forward as a bus conductor. It's a much more acceptable profession than an accountant. And but that was the background. And in 1980, Margaret Thatcher deregulated long-distance bus services. And I just saw that as a great opportunity. And as I think back to 35 years ago, I think there was a great opportunity presented itself. The market was dominated by state operators. The economy was in a shocking condition, and people were complaining about poverty. And I'm just thinking that 35 years later, in Europe, nothing much has really changed in that respect. We're stood on the verge of a great opportunity. The market is dominated still by state players, and we've had a poor economy for many years. It seemed like this was a very challenging situation to be in, but we discovered that bringing a new long-distance bus product to the market was just what people were looking for as they were looking at their finances and looking at their budget. And it's amazing that in Europe today, I think we're on the verge of an even bigger opportunity. And I'm very excited by the changes we are seeing here in the European market. And I think that there is great potential for our industry going forward. I want to talk quickly about three things, and I do realize this is not a good position to have in the program. I'm all that stands between you and your dinner tonight, so I don't want to keep you any longer than is necessary. But I think the first thing I observe is that we live in a society where there are changing social behaviors. In January, there was an article in our newspapers in Britain. This young man, Adam Greenwood, went to the toilet on a Virgin train. After he had sat down and finished, he discovered that there was no paper in the toilet. And so, as all of our young people do, he tweeted on his phone to say, "I'm stuck in the toilet and I have no paper." Someone at Virgin Trains, who monitors the social media, picked up his message. They called the guard on the train and asked him to take a toilet roll down to the toilet. Welcome to the 21st century. Life is changing. We live in a different age from what I was brought up. The internet and social media are king. It used to be that we responded to letters that people sent us. Now, with Wi-Fi on our buses, we're responding minute by minute to the problems that they are having. As companies, we can either stand on the sidelines and watch the world pass us by, or we can engage. A measure of Virgin, which is one of the smartest, most customer-oriented companies, was that they responded to Adam's tweet from the toilet. I wonder in this room how many of our companies would be so quick to respond to our customers' needs. One of my jobs at Stagecoach as chief executive was to review Twitter. I gave up my chief executive post just over 2 years ago. And one of the first jobs I passed to my successor was reviewing the social media. It was very depressing. I used to review the social media review of all the different companies. So I would start reading about First Group and National Express, and I felt so good. I thought, these companies are so stupid. Isn't that shocking? Imagine being so stupid as to do this. Or, you know, why did National Express let a customer down in this way, you know? And then I would get on to the Stagecoach sheets and I would become very, very depressed when I realized that we were just as big a failure as our competitors. The answer, of course, is not to read it. The answer is to try to reduce the amount that you're reading about yourself on social media. 35 years ago, when I started the Stagecoach company, we thought what we were doing was very dynamic because we answered the phone when the phone rang. That seems really, really silly thing to say in 2015. But in 1980, the transport companies that I had worked for before I started my own company, we didn't answer the phones. I mean, why would we answer the phones? It was just customers. I mean, they would find the bus eventually. What was the point of speaking to them? It cost us money. You know, they were really just a nuisance to us, you know. And I determined that we were always going to answer our phones. The second thing we did was we introduced marketing as a concept. And that seemed like a really dynamic concept at the time. I dug out one of the old marketing plans we had, and there was all sorts of things on it. But we, down at the bottom of it, we bought a rabbit costume. And we had a magic rabbit as a marketing ploy. And I think it cost us about 100 euros for the rabbit costume. And this rabbit was running around marketing the bus services in Glasgow. And we had to stop it because so many of the children were leaving school and following the rabbit around. And eventually, I think someone in Glasgow skinned our rabbit and we had to take the rabbit out. But it was very dynamic to market bus services because the rest of the companies, the state companies, said, why would you market a bus service? What a stupid thing to do. People need a bus, they'll find the bus. And, you know, they have to travel anyway. We're the only company they can travel with. What's the point of marketing? And unfortunately, that's really, you know, the market that we came into in 1980. And then the other thing we did was we innovated because at that point, there really wasn't much innovation. And that was sad because in the 1930s, there was enormous innovation before there was regulation. There was sleeper coaches. I've copied that. There was food on coaches. I've copied that. All of these things were done in the 1930s. And yet somehow, after the regulations started to come in, the industry became less and less entrepreneurial and less exciting. And so we brought some enterprise and innovation back into the bus business with the types of vehicles that we used and the types of services that we provided. Today's companies, of course, have got to be engaged in the social media, and any company that has a future has to be engaged. And digital commerce is the other big change that's coming in social behavior. So we've had the internet, but now we have the digital revolution upon us. And these changing social behaviors and how people make their decisions, we ignore that at our peril. So the challenge and the opportunity today comes from changing social behavior. And some big pluses in this, because we canvassed the views of all our customers a few years back and found that our customers were very aware of the environment and wanted to travel on environmentally friendly vehicles, were willing to park their car and use the car less if the bus service was convenient for them. And so we plugged into a very rich vein, especially in some of our provincial networks. In places like Cambridge and Exeter, we found that there was an enormous willingness to use public transport, sometimes for the first time, if the environmental credentials were correct. So changing social behaviour, in my view, is not a negative, it's a positive, but only if we can see how to capitalise on the opportunities. I think the second thing that we're seeing is a changing competitive landscape. And this is tied to the digital revolution to some extent. Ryanair, who started really the discount airline in Europe, quite like Megabus in many ways, started in a very simple and cheap fashion, was the market leader, then was overtaken by people that were introducing new technologies. Ryanair has 200 young people in a technical campus outside Dublin trialing new products and working out how to apply the digital developments to their company. We've seen the emergence of aggregators in our long-distance bus industry, people who want to interface with your customer and my customer, and people like Skyscanner. I mean, the airlines lost out on this completely by missing that development. And now most of the legacy airlines are having to pay the aggregators, people like Skyscanner, money for bringing the customers to them. Why is someone like Skyscanner successful? Answer, because they present the information to the customer in a way that's easy for them to follow. And they do very clever digital tools to do that. So I believe that in this changing environment, we have to respond to that. We have to develop that in that way, or we will lose our interface with our customer to other people, third parties, and that's never a good position for us to be in. A great example of this, of course, would be Uber, where they don't own any taxis or operate any taxis themselves, yet they're the biggest taxi firm in the world because they are bringing all the customers through their app and through their websites. There's great opportunity in this. I mean, Starbucks, if you're in the Starbucks app, they will ping you and tell you, you've just arrived in town, why don't you come in and you'll have a coffee for half price. All our bus customers, and we have millions of them, travel on our buses with GPS and Wi-Fi. We know where they are. And yet, you know, if I buy an item from Amazon for, you know, 60 euros, they will annoy me every day for the next 3 years. Yet if you travel on one of my traditional stagecoach services and spend 2,000 euros a year, you won't necessarily hear from us at all. So we have big challenges. There are great opportunities, but we need to be in a different relationship with our customers than what we have been in the past. And Google, a tech company talking about bringing in electric cars, you know, the world is changing very, very fast, and transport companies need to adjust just as fast. Fantastic opportunity for us. If you take Stagecoach and our local bus services, you know, 90% of our customers say they're satisfied with our service. That's a great starting point. But we need to get in a relationship with them, and we need to lever that relationship through digital technology so that we can actually be selling other products to them as well as public transport. And since we have started putting Wi-Fi in nearly all of our local buses, we found that people will log in, so we're beginning to get that relationship going because of the availability of Wi-Fi, which is a unique selling proposition for us in public transport. It's the one thing you can't do when you're driving your car, or you ought not to do when you're driving your car. So relationships with customers are key, and we have to move very fast in this area. So that's the second thing. Not only are there changing social behaviours, there's a changing competitive landscape, and there are changing opportunities for us arising. And some of this is arising out of the change in politics. A great example would be the Macron Act in France. None of us really believed it would ever really happen, but it has. What an enormous opportunity for all of us. And the British experience, I think, is important here, because people are now looking at a deregulated environment 20, 25, 30 years later. And this is what's been achieved. We have doubled the number of people using our railways since we moved them into the private sector. That's an amazing achievement. We've stopped the decline in patronage and started to get passenger growth in our bus services. We have got a vibrant manufacturing industry which has developed off the back of that. And we have reduced the social cost of public transport very, very significantly by developing a commercial model. And my view is this all started in 1980 when Margaret Thatcher deregulated the long-distance buses. Then they saw how successful that was. Then people began to think this private model may have wider applications. And I believe that may very well be the path that we are moving down across Europe. I'm not saying it will go universally, but in some countries it will move faster than others. It will lead politicians to think, is there a better way or a different way of doing this, where we can reduce costs, create modal shift, create successful commercial models where people have multiple choice about what kind of trips they can choose. And that's one thing we have learned. If you've got a vibrant railway with multiple choice and you've got a great coach service, you'll have more people using public transport and less people driving cars. And success for a politician is to have more people using public transport. So I'm very excited about the prospects, and I believe that these developments in Europe just now are going to precipitate enormous organic growth. We will see some consolidation. We've already seen, Flixbus and Mindfernbus come together. I believe we will see the state getting out of operating these businesses. There is no reason for the state to operate transport businesses, in my view, and I don't believe it's desirable. I know that in our country, the only thing the state tried to do in their own right was to build two aircraft carriers, and they're now 10 years behind target and costing four times what they originally estimated they would cost. Yes, the state should run healthcare. Yes, the state should run education services. But really, we are learning that the less the state does in the industrial sector, the more sense that it makes. Now, there's a competition going on in Europe just now, and there are two types of companies out there. There are companies that are led by emperors, and these companies that are led by emperors are for the most part in state ownership. Emperors like to accumulate things, but they like to keep their toys, and they don't want to share them with anyone else. Entrepreneurs are risk takers. They want to try new things. They're willing to give things a go. And there's going to be a battle happen over the next couple of years between the emperors and the entrepreneurs. I guess you don't need to work out what side I'm on in this battle. But it will be interesting because at the end of this, we may have a very vibrant coach business in Europe that could actually be world class and could be leading the whole world. It could be very exciting indeed. And Stagecoach, I believe, has in its day been a very dynamic company. Megabus was a reinvention of the original Stagecoach Express. I worked out about 15 years ago that the invention of the internet needed to be applied to public transport. We needed to think how we could create new businesses with that. And so I relaunched the express services just using the internet, 100% internet booking, with amazing results. We now are operating in about 9 or 10 different countries. It's been a very successful product. In 2002, 2003, when we did our pilot scheme, we just spent about €20,000 setting up the website, and we used 2 old double deckers. And it's now a business that's about €300 million, and it's, as I say, the rest of it is history. But here's the question: where is our industry going for the future? Changing social behaviours, changing competitive landscape, changing opportunities. But what does the future hold for our companies? And I think that a lot of that lies in our own hands. I didn't have time to prepare this, and there's tons of people in the room, you can't see it, but I have a graph here, and I'll tell you what it says. It's to do with all these digital companies. And on one side of the graph is universality. That's how universal is this application, for instance. My funeral is 100% universal, because you're all going to die. But it doesn't happen that often, I hope. And along the other graph is frequency. So for instance, my Ferrari is at the very bottom of both sides of this graph. It's not very universal, and my Ferrari doesn't happen very often. And interesting enough, most of these really luxurious products have got the least application for digital. Then as you go along this graph, you've got lifetime, annual, 6 months, 3 months, weekly, daily, hourly, by the minute. Right up in the top section here, we have Google, Facebook. They are happening all the time, and they've got very high universality. The companies in this top end of this graph here are valued on multiples of 35 to 40 times earnings. The companies that are in the traditional business sector, which sit in this part of the graph, are valued at between 6 and 8 times earnings. Do you want to increase the value of your company? Well, if you do, you need to move it from this part of the graph to this part of the graph. And let me give an example of some people that have managed to do that. You know, Amazon has moved from being a web stock to being a digital tech stock. LinkedIn has moved from being just a regular business with a website to being a web stock. And Skyscanner sits in this middle bit here as a web stock. Amazon sits here as a web stock. The problem with us is we're all in the old economy part of this graph. And so what we have to do is to think, how can we digitalize our business and move it into the web stock part, which we've tried to do with Megabus, and which some of our companies in Europe are doing very successfully, Flixbus and so forth, with their companies. It's interesting that in the Flix model, they don't operate any bus services themselves. It's like Uber. What you don't want to be is just to be the supplier. You want to be the relationship with the customer. You want to be in control of your own brand, and you want to be in control of your own goodwill and your customers. These are interesting times. I saw the opportunity in 1980 to start long-distance buses and take advantage of deregulation. When I did, there was a lot of people said, these people from Stagecoach are crazy. They were right. We are absolutely crazy, that bit they are right about. But they also said, buses are different. They're really special. you can't apply normal business practices to operating a bus company. And the older people, when I was young, were wrong about all these things. You can apply normal business practices. You can apply the digital revolution to the transport companies. I can't do that now because I'm 61 and I have a Nokia 63210 or whatever, so I don't understand enough about it to do it. But what I don't want to be is, I don't want to be the old person that says buses are really different, our industry is really special, other people really don't understand our industry, normal business practices can't be applied to our industry. I don't want to be the old person that says that. I want to be the old person that facilitates the young people that are coming up, that facilitates the visionaries that know what they're doing. I believe that we stand on the edge of a new golden age of European coach travel. And I believe that as an industry, from what I have seen looking around the exhibition, I think as an industry, we're ready to take up the challenges. Thank you.